So let's get some terms correct to start with. This will be a continuing theme of my talk this afternoon. We absolutely must be clear about terminology and language, all right? There's too much ambiguity and uncertainty across all of the management discipline. We must be clear what the terms are. So the underlying science here is known as system dynamics. It is the application of engineering control theory to economic and social systems. It was developed in the 1960s by a truly wonderful and very clever professor at MIT by the name of Professor Jay Forrester. Everything I'm going to say this afternoon, I owe to Professor Forrester, okay? There's a phrase that you move forward by standing on the shoulders of giants. And Professor Forrester is the giant on whose shoulders I'm standing. It is very widely applicable. It is used in environment, it's used in biology, it's used in healthcare, defense, business, economics. It is a very widely applicable science. You will find books and you will find articles talking about business dynamics, and that is the application of this method to business issues. It turns out that exactly the same principles are applicable to public policy, to nonprofit organizations, to parts of organizations, to whole organizations, to ecosystems of organizations. It's all the same principles, right? And the phrase that I've adopted, strategy dynamics, there's a very simple reason for that, and that is if you go and talk to ordinary executives and you start using the system word, they think you're talking about IT, all right? So although the method is called system dynamics, I talk to management about this because this is more managerial, if you like, and it doesn't come with that association with IT. Now, we could spend very little time on this because the underlying principles are extremely simple. And here they are. First of all, what is it we are trying to explain and what is it we are trying to manage? We are trying to explain and manage how performance changes over time. Now, in my world, performance is cash flow or it's sales. In other situations, it is the quantity and quality of service that is delivered. But whatever it is, it's about how performance changes over time. System dynamics has nothing to say about a static view of the world. The second part of the principle is that that performance, if you freeze time, that performance is always explained by the current quantity of items that are known as stocks. They are technical, it's a technical definition of variables that behave as asset stocks. I will explain to you what these things are. They're all around us. We all understand them, right? There's nothing mysterious. It's just that they're different than the performance things. And the third principle is that these resource stocks accumulate. They fill up over time and they drain away over time, like water in a tank or cash in a bank account. Right? They fill up and they drain away over time. Now, because they fill up and drain away over time, the performance that depends upon them moves up and down over time. And those relationships are very clear, they're very well understood, they aren't complicated. Right? So you don't need any scary maths here to deal with these issues. Pretty much anyone with a reasonable education can do this. The next thing we want to know is why do these asset stocks accumulate? Why do we win customers? Why do we lose customers? Why do staff leave us? why does reputation increase? Why does reputation fall? And it turns out that all of these things accumulate or deplete because of decisions we take, external factors outside of our control, and the existing stocks in the system. Okay? Now, the relationship between the existing stocks, the flow rates, the stocks, and the performance gives rise to feedback. Feedback can accelerate growth, it can accelerate decline, and it can cause limits to growth, and with delays added, you can get cyclicality. You can get boom and bust. You can get these dynamic performance outcomes that we're concerned about. What this gives you, and this is what's distinctive about this, this gives you a quantified working model of the enterprise. Now, my background is in corporate strategy. That's what I've done for 40 years. And I got very frustrated with the strategy field because they talk about frameworks and models all the time. And the models they talk about, I don't mean to be unkind, but they are not models. They are statues. They are statues. They have got pieces bolted together that give you a frozen statue of the thing you're trying to describe. So when you look at business models in the strategy field, they are statues. What should a model do? A model should do what the real world does. If you think about an aircraft simulator, when a pilot trains in an aircraft simulator and they move the controls, the simulator moves in the same way that a real aircraft moves. And if the simulated wind direction changes, then the simulator will move in the same way that a real aircraft would move if the wind changed, right? So that's what we mean by a model. It does what the real world does. When a drug company invents a new molecule to attack some disease, the molecule in the software looks like the real molecule, and it does the same thing as the real molecule over time. Those are real models. The models we talk about in management are statues. They are frozen in time. They don't do anything. They're just a picture. It's the difference between a photograph and a movie, if you like. Okay, so that's what you get. You get a working model of the enterprise, which does what the enterprise does. There's only one little technical piece you need to understand, and that's this thing in the middle about this resource accumulation. Now, when you've understood that, you end up with three equations, and that is the equation of the field, right? If you've understood that, then you can go and have coffee, and we'll meet again at 4:30. That's essentially what we have. It's not a long, complex theory. So what do I mean is accumulate? You all know how to do this. This is a bank account which started with $400 in it. And last month it had $400. This month it's got $450. This is a stock. This is a tank which contains money. So what that number is in there is how much of what is in the tank. And this is, think of this as a pipe, and this is a pump, and the pump is pumping money into the bank account. So the reason it's gone from 400 to 450 is because you have pumped $50 into the bank account. Anyone not understand that? Not difficult, right? This is not difficult. So that pump is pushing more into the tank, and it's cash that's flowing in, it's cash that's in the bank account. It's not people or rabbits or anything else, it's money. So if it's money in the tank, it must be money flowing in. Now, the slight complication is that as well as money going in, we might have money going out. So actually, this pump was pushing $250 in. So it must have been the case that there was another pump on the other side pumping $200 out. That's the only way those numbers reconcile. So this applies to all of these things called asset stocks. And this is an asset stock of customers. I use the word resources simply because that's what a language that ordinary executives understand. They understand the word resources. They usually mean cash or people, but customers are a resource, your product range is a resource, your capacity is a resource. Those are the five tangible things that make up the business. So here's customers, and we had 325 last month, 300 this month, we won 15, so a bit of audience participation here. How many did we lose? 40, yes, exactly, right. Okay, we lost 40. And if we multiply the number of customers we had by the amount we sold to them, then this is our sales. And sales went from this to this, because customers went from that to that. And sales per customer went from 10 to 11. And customers went from that to that, because that happened and that happened. All right? It's just drill back up the causality. That's all we're doing. We're starting with the outcome we're interested in, and we're drilling back up the chain of causality. And it is nearly always simple arithmetic. There are some exceptions, which I'll mention, but it's mostly simple arithmetic. And this continues through time. Now, this thing, the relationship between those numbers, this is not a theory. This is not the result of regression-based correlation studies with large data samples. It's not my opinion. It simply is how the world works. There is no other explanation for that number. Right? There is no other explanation for that number. This explanation is 100% correct with no error term. Right? Do you know how much money is in your bank account today? If you know how much money is in your bank account today, the amount of money in your bank account today is the sum of every dollar you ever paid in since the day you started the account, minus every dollar you paid out, to the cent. There is no other explanation for how much money is in your bank account. It's not explained by how many credit cards you have, or how many children you've got, or how big your mortgage is, or how many nights a week you go out to the nightclub, right? That's the explanation for the money in your bank account. No exception, no error term. It is a mathematical identity.